Hello, everyone. I'm Eric Bolling, along with Kat Timpf and Eboni K. Williams. 5 o'clock will never be the same. We are the Fox News specialists. We are. And today's specialist, he may be from Australia, but he's also started the Foundation for Liberty and American Greatness, and he's a best-selling author, but he specializes in everything Texas. Nick Adams is here. And she's a former congressional candidate in Virginia, a senior fellow at the New Leaders Council, and the author of the new book, Reversing the Apocalypse, Hijacking the Democratic Party to Save the World. But she specializes in blue crab picking. Crystal Ball is here. Crystal, just tell us, blue crab picking, not catching, the difference being?
The difference being that you pick them and then you eat them.
All right, and Nick Adams, how in the world did you become a Mr. Texas, or what is it? What is it?
Well, honorary Texan. I love chicken fried steak, bluebell ice cream, cowboy boots, jacked up pickup trucks, belt buckles. Where do I begin?
Who doesn't?
He sounds fully qualified.
That's right. So. The Southwest Texas accent.
Yeah, absolutely.
You ready to start?
Oh yeah, I'm so ready. I live for this.
Wait, what are we going to talk?
We're going to do this right now.
Let's get
to the top of the special list, the developing story out of our nation's capital. The House passing the Republican health care bill by a razor-thin margin of 217 yeas to 213 nays. It's a huge win for the Trump administration, though, and may have just saved Paul Ryan's speakership. The bill now heads to the Senate for consideration, where the fight will continue as it sits at 52-48 Republican, a thinner GOP margin than in the House. President Trump and House Republicans threw a victory celebration at the White House a short time ago, where the only thing missing was champagne and maybe a little confetti.
Make no mistake, this is a repeal and a replace of Obamacare. Make no mistake about it. What we have is something very, very incredibly well-crafted. We want to brag about the plan because this plan, really. Obamacare took 17 months. Hillary Clinton tried so hard, really valiantly, in all fairness, to get health care through. Didn't happen. We've really been doing this for 8 weeks, if you think about it. And this is a real plan. This is a great plan. And we had no support from the other party.
Well, Speaker Ryan also enjoyed the win.
This would not have been possible if it weren't for these two gentlemen behind me. I want to thank Mike Pence and I want to thank President Donald Trump for their personal involvement in working with our members and working to get this right, for getting this done and getting us to where we are. Today was a big day, but it is just one step in this process, an important step. We've got a lot of work to do. But one thing is now clear. Republicans are committed to keeping our promise to lift the burden of Obamacare from the American people and put in place a better, more patient-centered system.
No shocker, House Minority Leader Nancy Pelosi is singing a very different tune.
Any moderate in the crowd who voted for this bill turned radical today. I think they walked the plank. They were, I don't know, duped into walking the plank for a bill that will not become law.
Sorry, Minority Leader, Obamacare is dying, American health care is rising, and President Trump gets a big, beautiful, huge win. And frankly, as a conservative, I was very encouraged to see the GOP put their differences aside and pass massive legislation. Crystal Ball, Democrats must be shaking now. Here it is, Trump administration. This is a big win. This is a big one.
Yeah, I mean, he really came through and fulfilled his campaign promise to kick 24 million Americans off of health care. This is not at all what this president campaigned on. And I have to say, I think a lot of Democrats are kind of excited today because Republicans have basically committed political suicide here. I think the path to 2018, Dems retaking the House, is clearer than ever. And here's the even bigger win. No one in this debate is making the argument that Kat has been making, that it should truly be a free market solution, and if you can afford it, then you can buy in. No one is making that argument. So now the debate is, how do we best cover every American? We have essentially accepted in this country that health care is a right and not a privilege, and ultimately, I think where that
leads
to
single payer. That's a big statement, though. I mean,
it's pretty similar. This plan is pretty similar, and the way that it's happened is even faster than Obamacare. Remember when Paul Ryan was saying you should never vote on something like this without CBO analyzing it? Paul Ryan is going to be very mad at Paul Ryan when Paul Ryan finds out. You know, it's just everything's back and forth. And I do believe there's still too much of a government focus. Like you said, it's not a free market plan. That's what people like Rand Paul still don't like it, and why people like me still don't like it.
All right, Nick Adams, though, let's talk about the politics for a second. Donald Trump contrary to what Crystal Ball said, he didn't promise to have fewer Americans covered. He promised to repeal and replace Obamacare. He's well on his way to that campaign promise.
Well, call Donald Trump Lazarus, because just 6 weeks ago, people were saying that this health care bill was dead, buried, and cremated. And all of a sudden, Donald Trump, the president, has pulled out a great victory. Is this a touchdown? No, but it's certainly a first down. The ball has been advanced. And for 7 years, Republicans were kind of just bobbing in the slipstream of the Democratic Party. And all of a sudden now there's some action. I think it's a great day. I think it's something that we should celebrate. Obamacare was terrible, is terrible. And I think that this is great progress.
And Ebony, this is 1/6 of the American economy. This is a big legislative deal, okay? We spend around 17% of American income, GDP, on health care. Other countries don't come anywhere near that. The world is somewhere around 9.5-10%. The EU is about 10% as well. This is a long time coming.
Yeah, and it's huge, and it's humongous, and it's a very, very big, important deal. I believe in giving credit where credit is due for Donald Trump and the GOP. Today is certainly, in the words of Ice Cube, a good day. However, you know, I want to talk long-term and short-term. I think Crystal makes a really good point about the long-term. Short-term, there's no question this is politically a win. He gets to deliver very literally on that campaign promise, at least the first part of it, that repeal portion. But long-term, I think they're going to be real questions. And I'm not, it's too early. I'm not even going to pretend to understand everything this bill does. I think Rand Paul,
that's okay.
Rand Paul was articulating this very effectively earlier on Cavuto's show. And I think until I see more, until America sees more, and until the Senate gets their hands on it in a way that can maybe make it reflective of something that's more free market, I certainly can't really make a conclusion around the quality of this bill.
And Kat, you're 100% right there. 52 Republican senators, they need 50. They got two. Rand Paul has already said, I need to see more. And Ted Cruz also.
Yeah, well, Paul Ryan, when we were talking about Obamacare, said he needed to see more. So you think that they could at least understand the argument. Like you said, when it makes up such a huge portion of the economy, you kind of want to know what you're doing before you do it. And we have a situation where health care is very expensive in this country. But the two reasons why it's expensive is because prices get jacked up when you get the government involved and when you get big insurance companies involved.
But
there's a difference between capitalism. There's a difference between capitalism and crony capitalism.
About this for a minute, though. We have the most robust private insurance market in the world, and we have the most expensive health care, and we have some of the worst outcomes in the developed world. Where we need to go is where the rest of the developed world has already gone, and where I guarantee whoever Democrats nominate in 2020 are going to go.
What outcomes are you talking about? Hang on, you said we have some of the worst outcomes.
We do.
We have people coming from around the world to use our healthcare system.
In this country right now, whose life expectancy is going down.
Yeah, but not because of our healthcare system, because of our smoking or obesity.
Because we don't have any preventative care, because you still have so many Americans without health care. I agree with you that Obamacare has problems.
Democrats think this is a terrible bill. But it almost looks just like Obamacare.
No, it does.
That's
why
you love it.
Wait a second. If it looks just like Obamacare, why do you love it?
Obamacare was the savior, and now it's Trump care, so it's awful.
No. Listen, the last bill that the CBO did score had 24 million fewer people getting health insurance through this bill. That is why we hate this bill. This bill makes it worse, and I'll tell you what it is. This only makes sense as basically a tax cut for the rich, which is what it is, at the expense of the working
poor. You don't know that. You can't make that.
Of course you can.
You can't say Paul Ryan shouldn't have voted on or shouldn't push it until he scored it, and then go ahead and score it yourself.
This is based on Ryan's bill. This one is even worse than what the CBO scored.
No.
True.
Come on, Nick.
I'm still disturbed, honestly, Eric, that you said that it's almost like Obamacare, as if that's a good thing. That's the most depressing thing.
I'm talking about Democrats saying Obamacare was amazing. It was wonderful. Paul Ryan puts together a bill, a legislation that looks a lot like Obamacare, but fixes some things in Obamacare.
Like
pre-existing conditions.
I didn't say they don't care about them, but I'm talking about what this bill does.
And then Democrats say, well, that's there.
Let me say this one thing, Crystal.
No.
There are also those of us who do not like Obamacare, which I've been very clear and consistent on.
Yeah.
We're did not vote for Donald Trump, but was consistently rooting and expecting and hoping for something better, because I was one of those people that paid the penalty. And
you do realize the Senate will get their hands on
that's
that bill and put a lot of things into the bill.
That's what I said. I'm waiting. There's
a long way to go in this process. The Senate, I'm sure, is going to be very vigorous in its assessment of it. But let me just take you up on one thing, Crystal. Let me tell you, as somebody that spent 32 years in a country with socialized medicine, that is not the future that you want for the United States of America, for sure. And that's why it's really important.
Better outcomes, lower costs.
That's
what it
really
looks like in Australia and other countries with single-payer health care. And that's where we're going, because people have accepted this debate that health care is a right.
That is a leap. That is
not a privilege.
That is absolutely incorrect.
The only way that you ensure coverage is single payer.
There's not a conservative in this country that has accepted that premise that health care is a right.
Then why did we spend so much time debating about people getting access who have pre-existing conditions?
Because the political consequences are very high at this point, Crystal. That's the truth. The political consequences for someone coming out and saying the reality of making more coverage for more people and bringing down health care premiums is virtually impossible under the current economic model.
Right, that's why you need single payer. That's why you need
bottom line.
Well, you need free market.
There's no incentive to provide better care. Great idea.
So let's get back to that. So the reason why you're saying that health care is a right in the country is because they called it they called the mandate constitutional, right? Is that
John Roberts called it that's
the only reason why you could say that. Once you remove the mandate, which this bill, this new legislation does, it no longer becomes a right or a mandate.
I'm talking about the philosophy of the country. The country has rejected this bill. It only had 20% support in the previous iteration, which was not as brutal and cruel as what they just passed. The country voted for Donald Trump in part because he said, I'm going to provide you with health care coverage, and I'm going to bring down premiums.
Well, why do you wait
people
and see?
Do not
Crystal,
think
why
that health care should be
happens?
A privilege for the wealthy. And this bill is a step in that direction. Wait and see. You're going to wait and see?
Yeah.
Were you happy when Nancy Pelosi said we've
got to
pass the bill before we can know what's in it?
There is no
way. You got to know what's in the bill before you pass it.
You wanted to run for Congress, right?
I did run for Congress.
Do you think... Okay. Do you think that they would put together a bill that would go to the Senate, come out, and President Trump would sign a bill that would make it worse for average middle-class Americans? Do you think that would make it through? Of course it would not.
Totally
they would get destroyed in 2018.
I don't think... Yes, They will.
They won't.
And to be honest with you, I don't see that this president has dug into the details of this bill. I think he did want to provide something that was better, and maybe the House let him down. Maybe he doesn't want to do the homework to know what's in this bill. But how do you look at the fact that every analysis finds that millions and millions of people will lose their health care coverage? Premiums will go up. If you have pre-existing conditions, you're in big trouble.
And you know what
lifetime
the alternative
caps,
was? You know what the
that
alternative
piece
was?
Is
Obamacare,
back. Everything
which,
we hated.
Obamacare was failing upon itself. Health insurers were completely pulling out of states.
Yeah, do you know why?
So if you stayed on Obamacare, people would have no coverage and no options.
So
that was not the best alternative.
Let's fix Obamacare.
Let's fix this one. How about we give the guy a chance?
She's got the crystal ball, but I think she's jumping the gun.
We're headed to single payer, guys.
Susan Rice refusing to testify before the Senate next week over Trump's surveillance allegations. The president had a few choice tweets from Ms. Rice this morning. And later, President Trump signing a groundbreaking executive order to defend religious liberty. Those stories and more coming up, but make sure to follow us on social media at SpecialistFNC on both Twitter and Facebook.
Susan Rice is back in the headlines, this time for not wanting to testify for allegations surrounding her unmasking of members of the Trump team. Remember, she was President Obama's top security advisor. This got POTUS pretty heated, as you could imagine, tweeting, quote, Susan Rice, the former national security advisor to President Obama, is refusing to testify before a Senate subcommittee next week on allegations of unmasking Trump transition officials. Not good. Meanwhile, even those in her own party, like California Democratic Senator Dianne Feinstein, is urging Rice to reverse course.
I think she ought to consider it. She has gone public. I saw her on Fareed's show Sunday. Mm-hmm. I saw her today. And it seems to me that, I guess I've never heard that it has to be a bipartisan letter. This is sort of a new criteria, but she's certainly within her rights of saying, I'm now retired, I'm not going to do it.
Okay, Nick, so obviously, yes, she's in her right to refuse it, to kind of effectively plead the fifth, so to speak. But what about what the senator is saying here? Did Susan Rice kind of open the doors, we would say, in the law by being so public about it, going on all these Sunday shows, at least discussing it in some way, and therefore this kind of backing away from it in the Senate format looks unsavory?
Look, Eboni, to put it mildly, I think that Susan Rice has got a very casual relationship with the truth.
We've kind of seen. What do you mean?
Well,
that's sarcasm.
We've seen it over and over and over again.
Yes, of course.
Throughout her career, yes. And I think that this doesn't pass the pub test. I think this smells. Okay. And I think that it can easily be seen as an admission of guilt for her to take this particular
really?
Position.
What?
Absolutely. And okay. The fact that she's getting fire from one of her own, I think, says a lot.
Coming right to you, Crystal, I think you have something to say on this. So, to that point, we'll get to Senator Feinstein, but what's in it for Susan Rice to testify at this point? What would be
exactly.
The upside for her to go for? People already think, as Nick points out, that she has a casual relationship with the truth. What benefit would it be for Susan Rice to go in front of this committee?
Well, that's exactly it. I mean, look, I get Republicans hate Susan Rice. They don't like her. We get that. They think she's a liar, as Nick just said, all of that stuff. But these completely unfounded and baseless allegations against Susan Rice are totally irrelevant to what this investigation is supposed to be about, which is the Trump campaign potentially colluding with Russia to essentially commit an act of war against our own country.
Except,
that is what those investigations
they're
are about.
Not really that unfounded. We already know Susan Rice lied about saying that the reason for the Benghazi attack was a video. She was told it wasn't.
How
she
is
was
that?
Still. Well, that was then.
Irrelevant.
No, it's not irrelevant. So she's a proven liar. We know that. And number two, she went ahead and unmasked Trump officials when it. We know that.
Well, I think we don't.
Let me step in for a second, please.
The standard for unmasking that information is that it has to provide some foreign intelligence value,
which is very
which
wide
is a
scope.
Very,
That's
very
a wide scope.
Vague qualification.
Yes.
It's a very wide scope, which is exactly why kooky libertarians like myself are always talking about government surveillance being too intrusive, mm-hmm. these standards being too broad and too wide in scope. And I'm so confused as to seeing why so many people are still such big fans of big intrusions into our privacy
and our
that are on the same side of the people that are saying that she did something wrong. I think that we should talk about this. Obviously, what she did was politically motivated. I think that that's obvious. But also, she can get away with it, most likely, on a constitutional basis, based on that very broad line standard.
You and I have very similar opinions on the NSA and privacy and whatnot. I think this exactly goes right to that, where Susan Rice, contrary to the CIA, the FBI, and NSA, who said, we don't need to unmask this guy's name, she said, no, let's unmask it. And as you aptly point out, it was all politics. She should have kept that name masked because it was not supposed to be unmasked.
Right.
And if you have nothing to hide, go testify.
This is something we have the right to do, it's because we're so surveillance happy, and we need to take a look at that.
Okay, so we're going to pivot now. James Comey yesterday confirmed what many suspected, that it was classified information, in fact, forwarded from Huma Abedin to her husband, Anthony Weiner. When asked if it should be considered a crime, Democratic Senator Richard Blumenthal, well, he said this.
If there was classified information and it was improperly passed to a person unauthorized to receive it, yes, naturally it's a crime without knowing what the intentions were and so forth. There is potentially a prosecutable crime.
Should it have been prosecuted?
It still may be, potentially. It's not outside the statute of limitations, so far as I know, is one that the Department of Justice is going to have to decide. And the question is, who will decide it? That's why we need a special prosecutor to review all of this investigative material.
So, I'm actually going to come to you on this. Remember, had the privilege of filling in for the Thanksgiving special of the five, and Huma was my turkey of the year. Is this just the gift that keeps giving in the worst way for her? Is she become the scapegoat of the Dem Party?
When you have Richard Blumenthal recommending a special prosecutor looking into what happened, we all know she sent classified information, we know, to Anthony Weiner. The only reason why we know it is because Anthony Weiner was being investigated for texting or sexting a 15-year-old girl.
Sure. Horrible.
And so they had his computer, and they, oh, wow, look at this. We have Hillary Clinton's classified information.
Sure.
Yeah, hello, let's go prosecute. Let's go find out what he knows she did.
To the point that it is coming from her own party at this point, Crystal, mm-hmm. How much more does that bolster the suspicion around it?
I mean, I don't know. Do people really want to go back and relitigate the Hillary email thing and Huma Abedin? I mean, fine. If there's something, some wrongdoing there, then I have no problem with people looking into it. So, yeah, the fact that it's a Democrat saying this. But it also shows that Democrats are not just reflexively partisan here. They're not just reflexively saying, no, because it's one of ours, we shouldn't go after them. If there was wrongdoing, let's look into it.
I like that point that Crystal's making, but I'm a little suspicious. Is that causal, right? Is that really how we should read that? Or is this just because it's Huma and it's Anthony Weiner and people are so sick to death of them, including in the Democratic Party, and they will happily throw them under the bus?
Yeah, I think you're right, Eboni. I think that it really is just these couple of examples that we're looking at right now. I don't think you can possibly say...
I will certainly throw Anthony Weiner under the bus.
Okay, to be clear, at least we can all agree on that.
He seems to do a pretty good job of that himself. He walks right out in front of it.
Just the hottest of hot mess.
You know why this really matters? Because you have to prosecute bad behavior. This was bad behavior. When Huma Abedin, a trusted and cleared assistant, pushes classified material to someone who doesn't have that clearance, you can't say it's okay this time. Don't do it again.
I think people feel bad for her, though, because she is married to the most embarrassing man in the entire universe. That only can take it so far. You do have to, if you could just marry an embarrassing man and suffer no consequences, I would have gotten married a long time ago, but I know that's not how it works.
My wife would argue with that.
There does come a point where you say, okay, you know what, but if we're talking about the matters of our national security and there might be something to be found here, we all should be on the side of let's take a look at it.
I'm going to go on a deeper level, Kat. You know what? It's not just an accident that she married the most embarrassing man on the face of the earth. That was a choice. And I think that we all have to, seriously, we have to be very accountable for the people that we connect ourselves to, especially our spouses.
I think she has suffered plenty for her choice there.
And maybe more so. Even Colbert refusing to apologize for his off-color joke about President Trump. But will the social media frenzy to fire Colbert blow up even more than it already has? Stay with us.
Colbert is not backing down amid an outcry for him to be fired. Last night, the Late Show host finally addressed the uproar around the controversial joke he made about President Trump earlier this week.
Still? Am I still the host? I'm still the host! Now, folks, if you saw my monologue on Monday, you know that I was a little upset with Donald Trump for insulting a friend of mine. So, at the end of that monologue, I had a few choice insults for the president in return. I don't regret that. I believe he can take care of himself. I have jokes, he has the launch codes. So, it's a fair fight. So while I would do it again, I would change a few words that were cruder than they needed to be.
So, is his non-apology only adding fuel to the Fire Colbert campaign? Look, I don't know about you guys. I am a big fan of the non-apology in my own life, because if you apologize for something and you don't mean it, you say you regret it when you don't regret it, that really just diminishes the value of the apology.
Got everything covered.
Yeah, absolutely.
Look, here's where I stand on this. I don't think he needs to be fired. He needs a sincere apology. That wasn't it. He needs to apologize to Donald Trump, the president, for taking... Yeah, I mean, can you imagine? Donald Trump is president. You don't make those kind of jokes.
Oh, my gosh.
But also, wait. And also, he owes the LGBT community an apology as well. They were very offended by it.
I am so glad he did not apologize. Liberals always apologize. We apologize for everything. Any time we hurt anyone's feelings, we apologize for it all the time. And look, he's right. The language didn't have to be so crude. Although I saw you guys talking earlier, you all didn't think it was funny. I did laugh, I admit. Maybe that's because my sense of humor is down in the gutter. But look, I am so grateful that finally someone said, you know what, it was a joke. Let's move on with our life.
If he apologized, I would have made him apologize for apologizing.
Thank you, Kat.
I think the only thing you should have apologized for is how bad the joke was. That's my take, Crystal. But, you know, to your point, I don't think he should have really apologized because I don't think he's really sorry. I think that's what we know. Is he's not at all sorry for what he said about President Trump. He means it. He stands by it. So I do respect him for at least being honest around that.
He means what he said about President Trump?
Yes.
That his mouth is only good for one thing.
Maybe not literally, but figuratively.
That's what the difference between a joke and not a joke.
The United States, guys. I mean, come on. He should be held at a higher standard.
Without a doubt.
He's a comedian.
I'm here to tell you that Stephen Colbert is a third-rate mediocrity that is struggling for significance, that is looking for recognition. And can I tell you something? If brains were dynamite, he wouldn't have enough to blow his ears off. And I'll tell you why. He has just proceeded to alienate more than half of the country to which he broadcasts. It was disgraceful. It was crude. It was outrageous.
Wait, aren't you Crystal, anti-PC guy?
And Crystal, let me
tell
you.
Wait a second. I'm so
Crystal,
confused. Your whole thing is not being PC. Yeah. Eric, how many times have you talked about the
Bill Clinton? I don't think you should be
let
fired.
Me say this.
I'm sorry. Do we need a safe space for you guys?
No, but I'll tell you what you need.
If the shore on the other foot and the conservative insulted the LGBT community, don't
he did
you
not
think
insult
would...
the LGBT community.
Well, listen, I'm not
people
making
may have
it up.
Insulted, I'm not, but to not say insulted, that that was being homophobic with that joke is a stretch like this
Crystal,
thick.
I think you have what it takes to tear the hind legs off an entire herd of antelope. But I'm here to tell you that you're absolutely 100% wrong. Because this was totally out of line. This was wrong. Now, I'm not calling for him to lose his job. I don't think he should lose his job. But I think for you to sit here and tell us that it's perfectly okay.
Because I'm hearing from conservatives all the time that we're all so easily offended and we need to learn how to take a joke. And then I see that you guys need a safe space.
In what reality do you live in? You just told us that liberals apparently apologize. I've never heard a liberal apologize for anything.
Are you kidding me? All the time for everything, all the time.
Why is an apology out of the question? I mean, it was you offended some groups.
You said that he thought that the language was
too
crude. Okay, the language was too crude. Sure. Comedians push the line all the time. That's what they do. That's
he just had his knickers. He just had his knickers in a knot because Donald Trump upset his friend.
I don't
that's
know what he's the one with the knickers in the
I don't
knot
think he thought
scenario,
this was going to alter the course of the universe the way that it did. And I certainly didn't think it would either. But okay. All right. President Trump signs a landmark executive order to defend religious liberty. How far will it go to protect Americans of faith under assault? Don't go away.
Welcome back to the Fox News Specialist. Our specialists today are Nick Adams and Crystal Ball, who's author of the new book, Reversing the Apocalypse, Hijacking the Democratic Party to Save the World. All righty then. And let's continue the conversation. President Trump keeping another campaign promise, signing a milestone executive order over religious freedom, liberty, earlier today.
For too long, the federal government has used the power of the state as a weapon against people of faith, bullying and even punishing Americans for following their religious beliefs. With this executive order, we are ending the attacks on your religious liberty, and we are proudly reaffirming America's leadership role as a nation that protects religious freedom for everyone.
All right, Nick Adams, the president is probably out of breath a little bit. All those victory laps he had to take around the road garden today.
Don't get tired of winning, do we? That's been nice. Look, it is so refreshing, Eric, to have a president that cares about Christians. We have a president that is not coming out there and saying that Christians should get off their high horse. We don't have a president that's got more sympathy for Islam than Christianity. I think it's a fantastic thing that we have a president and a White House that are committed to protecting Christians, not only in America, but right around the world. And I think it's terrific that we are going to get more freedom as a result of this. Mm-hmm.
And Eboni, one of the big things about this bill is that religious groups can now not only campaign, but they can also say who they like without risking their tax-exempt status, and that really is an important part of it.
It is, and you know what, Eric? I actually like it. I do like it. I like more freedoms. Historically, that's been frowned upon by these groups. I have to tell you, as a both Christian and member of the Black community, historically, that's been important to us as a community, to be able to have the freedom to incorporate the sometimes inevitable intersection of faith, our faith and our belief system, and political engagement and involvement. So I'm actually quite pleased with it.
Let me just interject really quick. Actually, this executive order, you can't overturn a mandate or regulation or a statute. So this actually doesn't really do much of anything, because the ban on churches being politically involved comes from the Johnson Amendment. You can't just, I believe it's unconstitutional, but you can't overturn it with an executive order, just like you can't overturn the contraceptive mandate, which I also think is unconstitutional, but you can't overturn it with an executive order. I agree with the ideas in this. I think that if he wanted to repeal those things, good on him, that'd be great, but you can't just do something like this with an executive order.
Now, what do you say, Crystal?
Two things. First of all, I'm a little bit confused by what Nick said, because we realize this isn't a Christian freedom bill or executive order. This is about all religions. So, you know, Muslims also will benefit from the changes in this executive order. But to Kat's point, I'm not upset about this because it doesn't really do anything. The Johnson Amendment that you're talking about is already not enforced. Pastors and other faith leaders already go to the pulpit and walk right up to and frequently over the line in terms of politics.
Can I give an anecdote about it real quick? I'm going to let you finish that point.
Sure, sure.
So I had a friend campaigning for mayor of Cincinnati just this past week. His primary was on Tuesday. We went to three churches in the morning, and you could see the resistance, the pastors, many of them, who wanted to be able to speak out publicly about what they thought was in the best interest of their congregations. But, Crystal, they actually did feel like their hands were tied around their ability
to speak
about it.
You know why? Because they were risking their tax-exempt status. They were speaking out in favor of a candidate.
It doesn't actually technically change that. The Johnson Amendment is still there. He's just saying IRS don't enforce it. But the IRS is already not enforcing it. I do want to point out here that a lot of religious leaders are uncomfortable with the mixing of church and state, and they think that that separation is not only good for the state, but is also good for religion, because to pick up on something that Nick said last segment, you know, when you start explicitly advocating for politicians and political causes, it is a divisive thing, and it will turn off some believers and some people in your community. So this is a tough one, but this doesn't, I'm not too upset about it, because it doesn't actually
turn some people off, Crystal, and you're right about it. But again, I just have to speak on my personal experience. Sometimes they are so intrinsically linked. You cannot run away from the crossover around them. And I think in those instances, there should be some latitude.
The handcuffs are off. I think that's a great thing. I think that it's really important what President Trump signed today. I think it's going to have a very big impact. I think it's going to make people feel much more
comfortable. No, there's no impact. Nobody's going to be able to not obey the contraceptive mandate, for example, based on this executive order, because an executive order can't overturn that.
Sometimes it's not just about actual policy effects. Sometimes it's about the effect it has on the culture, on the psyche.
Yeah,
I think it's really, really a great thing that suddenly people feel comfortable, particularly Christians, because Christians are the most persecuted, I think, here in the United States.
Let's leave it right there.
I don't know about that. 100%.
Elizabeth Warren suggests that the Trump presidency could mark the end of male presidents in the White House. What is even happening next? And follow us on Twitter and Facebook at Specialist FNC. We have our say in no, no, no.
Leave it to Elizabeth Warren to have you asking, what is even happening? The hard left icon, who so accurately predicted a Trump presidency could not happen, is making another bold prediction.
The way that things are going, if the next 3 years and 261 days are like Donald Trump's first 100 days, I wonder if America will ever be ready for a male president again.
So, President Trump will be so horrible for America, the country will never, ever elect another male president again. I wonder who that would benefit in, say, 2020. I don't know. I got to ask you, Crystal. Did they not learn that maybe running an election or a campaign on identity politics does not work?
Well, I hope they will learn that. I don't know if they did. But I think with Elizabeth Warren, let's just keep in mind the context here. This was a joke. It was an applause line at an all-women's conference of Emily's List, which is all about getting more women into politics. So let's not pretend like Elizabeth Warren is actually saying, I hate men, no man is ever going to be elected president of the United States.
But it does.
That is not what she's saying
here. Of course not,
except
but it does present the same attitude, though, Eboni. It does present the same attitude of that, yet it's going to be a gender-focused election again. They're still thinking about elections in terms of a gender focus when that kind of didn't go great last time.
So I think both of you are saying something that is true, right? So I think absolutely the Dems have to get an economic message first and foremost. I've been saying that consistently, and if and when they do, we might see a different result. But I think Crystal's right. She is at Emily's List. That is an applause line. That is a talking point, essentially, around rallying. And it's an important cause. We do need more women and more
of
women.
Course.
By the way, of both Democratic and Republican and independent stature entering the political dialogue, the political space. So that's a good thing.
She didn't say more. She said,
I know.
But the thing of it this way, though, she's going to run for president, right? This is going to come back to haunt her in 2020 when she's going. I agree with you. This was a line to sell books. That's all that was. But this, you know, TV has a funny way of reminding you what you said a while ago.
But let's just
alienate a lot of male Democrats.
You may not like Elizabeth Warren. That's fine. But I don't think anyone would argue that this is not a mission-driven person who talks a lot about economics. I mean, in terms of the Democratic Party,
agreed.
I am the first
Absolutely.
To criticize the
Go
party. I wrote a whole book about it.
That's a better message than there'll never be another male president.
You know, 99% of her time on. But you've also got to say what you're going to be voting against. So it's fine to criticize Trump. You've just got to offer something else. I think Elizabeth Warren is one of the best at that. But let's also keep in mind,
I disagree
look,
with
Trump
you.
Ran as the alpha male, right? He talked about the size of his junk. He was the grab him by the you-know-what candidate. He ran as the alpha male who's going to come in and be tough. So it was a very gendered election. And I think when you think about what we're going to come to with in reaction to that, in response to that, we will probably
Donald Trump was more gender identity political than
I'm talking about the underlying dynamic, where are we going to go
I'll
after
tell you one
this
thing
from the
that
alpha
America
male
will never be ready for I'll tell you one thing America will be never ready for, and that is a president Elizabeth Warren. A president Pocahontas, whatever you like to call her.
Just don't do the Pocahontas thing.
Why not? It's true.
If you're going to criticize her,
this is what the left is.
Stick on the policy, please.
But look, let me tell you,
you
this.
Need a name call.
All that feminism has delivered is angry women and feminine men.
That's not true at all. Feminism, by definition, people don't understand what that word means. All it means is that you believe that the same rights that you have that are applicable to you are applicable to me.
This won't be solved right now. Okay. Back by popular demand, we're going to circle back to one of our top stories next. Cameras just caught up with Huma Abedin. Here's what she says when asked why she forwarded emails to her disgraced husband. Stay there.
Time for our daily segment, Circle Back. We debuted it on the show yesterday, and well, we didn't totally embarrass ourselves, so we're keeping it. So we're circling back to a topic we discussed earlier in the show today, Huma Abedin. So we just got in this new video of Huma being questioned by the New York Post on the streets of New York earlier today about why she forwarded classified information to her husband.
Do you feel partially, at least responsible for Hillary's defeat? Knowing that your emails reopened the investigation? Did you know that what you were doing was illegal? Mr. Comey said that he didn't think you were aware of that.
All right, in my opinion, Huma there looking the definition of unbothered. Eric.
Unbothered or very smart because she is likely going to be investigated, so she just want to open her mouth and say, a thing to anyone right
the
now.
The lawyer in me says that is very smart advice. Crystal, how's she look to you?
On a human level, I really feel for Huma, because she probably does blame herself a lot for Hillary's loss.
And shouldn't she?
And she married Anthony Weiner, and it's been hell for her, and now we've got this whole thing going. I mean, yes, she should, if there was wrongdoing, she should accept responsibility for that. There should be investigation, whatever. But on a human level, I feel for her in that clip.
I'm not a fan of Huma Abedin. Look, I think that she's brought a lot of it unto herself. I think that we saw there that she's very, very uncomfortable, and so she should be. I think she will get prosecuted. I think that there will be an outcome that's going to be adverse to her. And, you know, if Susan Rice is the Tokyo Rose of our time, then I think that that would probably make Huma Abedin perhaps the Joker.
I don't know what you're talking about. Huma and Huma Hillary 2020, she's unaffected. She's doing it. No, it's very, very sad. But what else are you going to do? What else are you going to do?
Yeah. Well, I liked her scarf. That was really nice.
It was a really nice
scarf. The glasses
were
nice. She's very stylish.
You
know, yeah.
If you've seen that Anthony Weiner documentary, you do end up feeling for Huma that she was, I mean, there was time and time again where the press would come in and say, look what we found, and they'd have the cameras rolling on her and she would keep going. But to your point earlier in the show, she made those decisions. Yeah.
Sometimes your emotions can take over.
We all know
what that's like.
People do funny things when they're in love.
I don't think it was emotional. I think Huma made a strategic decision that a lot of people do when they're choosing their spouse, right? I think she knew he was a hot mess. He'd get on her nerves. He would have some liability, so to speak. Mm-hmm. But I think she ultimately thought it would be worth it. He would become mayor of New York and maybe more.
She really
and
that
it would
that.
Be more.
That
oh, loved him too.
I think she might also be capable
too.
Of love. I think that's fair to
Eric,
say.
Eric, I think
Come
this
on.
Is where you and I have to.
look at the two people she chose, Hillary and Anthony Weiner. I don't know, loser one and loser two.
Ooh, yeah.
Marrying Anthony Weiner is
she
a bad thing.
Taste.
I would not have done it. And I don't plan to, so.
He's available, I think.
Yeah, I don't know. I thought
Go for it, Kat.
Well, I think one of the first things I ever said on Fox News was on Sean Hannity's show, and that is Anthony Weiner is not my husband.
Yeah.
Thank God for that. I mean, just you guys
just
be accountable
right
for
there.
Your truth. Right? That's the truth. That's the gospel right there. Well, thank you to our Fox News specialist today, Nick Adams and Krystal Ball. We thank you all so much for watching. Make sure you also follow us on social media. It's a new account, @SpecialistFNC on Twitter and Facebook. And remember, everybody, 5 o'clock will never be the same. Special Report up next.